Good morning, everyone, and a very warm welcome to you this morning on what's perhaps a little bit of a miserable day, and it looks like it's only going to get worse according to the reports, but there's hope ahead for some warmer weather, it seems. I'd like to extend a very special welcome to Daniel Wright, who's with us today, and he'll be sharing with us a little bit of the work that Reach Mentoring do. Over the Christmas period, we raised funds for three charities and over three services, and then we divided the collected amount into three amounts. So today we have a check for £300 to give to Daniel for the Reach Mentoring, and Daniel will share with us a bit of the work that they do, and there'll be opportunity for anyone who's interested. If you'd like to get involved in some way, Daniel will give you some information how you can do that. Some opening words. Last week I shared opening words from a hymn, the first verse, and today I share words from the second verse of that hymn, which read, "Let us build a house where prophets speak and words are strong and true, where all God's children dare to seek to dream God's reign anew. Here the cross shall stand as witness and as symbol of God's grace, and here as one we claim the faith of Jesus. All are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place." And with that we turn to our opening hymn number 975, "Before the Throne of God Above."
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong, a perfect plea, a great high priest whose name is Love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hands, my name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart. No tongue can bid me thence depart. When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and see him there, who made an end to all my sin. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me, to look on him and pardon me. Behold him there, the risen Lamb, my perfect spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased with his blood. My life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God, with Christ my Savior and my God.
Please be seated as we continue in prayer together. And we hear a verse from Jeremiah 33, verse 3. "Call to me, and I will answer you, says the Lord, and will tell you great and hidden things that you have not known." Let us pray. O gracious God, within us we find the fountain of your living waters, and endless fields of delight and goodness prepared by you for our health and our strength. And yet the wrongs of the world and of our lives reach deep into our very hearts and often seem to close us off from the ways that lead to your life springs, leaving parts of us in exile from you. In your mercy, open again the paths that you have established within us, which lead to your dwelling, so that once more we may find rest for our souls, and again learn truths hidden from outward sight, but written for us and all people in the inner heart. It is for a replenishing of strength, a restoring of health, that we pray, in the firm belief that a healing of our spirits is for the healing also of our families, of our nations, and our world. For we pray these things in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. One of the Christmas gifts that Wendy and I got was a box, a puzzle, a 500 or 1,000 piece puzzle. We haven't yet attempted it, but I wonder how many of you enjoy doing puzzles. I've seen when I've visited some people in their homes, I've sometimes seen puzzle pieces on a table or a tray. I think there might be a few who enjoy doing puzzles. And I wonder how many of you have experienced the frustration of doing a puzzle and finding near the end that there are some missing pieces. How frustrating is that, to discover a hole in this puzzle that will never be made complete because somewhere along the line a piece has just disappeared. Perhaps a dog may have eaten it for his breakfast, or a cat swished it off the table and it was gone under another piece of furniture. Well, sometimes I think our relationships can be like that. We can feel like that in our friendships with other people, that when we do or say things that hurt other people and we don't say sorry or we don't try and put it right, then sometimes it can feel like there are missing puzzle pieces in our friendship or our relationship. It begins to feel like there's a hole that we need to fill and we're not quite sure how to do it. It makes it so we don't always feel so easy to get on anymore. Maybe we feel a bit awkward, we don't know what to say because we know that something is wrong, something is missing. And when that happens, it is probably time to say sorry. Probably time to try and put things right. And sometimes it's not easy to say sorry. But when we do that, when we are able to find the courage, then it's like finding a missing puzzle piece that we can put in the picture again. In Matthew's Gospel, Jesus encourages us to find our missing puzzle pieces and to restore our broken relationships. And that's what our reading is going to be. Matthew chapter 5, if you'd like to turn with me. Matthew chapter 5, verse 23 to 26. In fact, we just do verse 23 to 25, I think, to 24. That's page 969. Matthew 5 from verse 23. And Jesus says to us, Therefore, if you are offering your gift at the altar, I see some people are still turning pages. Let's try that again. I think everyone may have found it now. Matthew 5 from verse 23. Therefore, if you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother or your sister has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First, go and be reconciled. In other words, make things right. Be reconciled to your brother or sister, and then come and offer your gift. Just so far, and we give thanks for that reading to us today. I had a song that I was going to play over the sound system, but I forgot to bring the Bluetooth. It was going to be an action song. So some of you might be disappointed, and others of you might be relieved. We're going to continue with our next hymn, number 37, As the Deer, in Mission Praise, number 37, As the Deer. Let's stand together. As the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. I want you more than gold or silver. Only you can satisfy. You alone are the real joy giver and the apple of my eye. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. You're my friend and you're my brother, even though you are a king. I love you more than any other, so much more than anything. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. Please be seated, and the youngsters are going to go up to the hall now, and then I'm going to invite Daniel. I'm going to invite Daniel to come up into the pulpit, because I think otherwise those who are upstairs won't really be able to see Daniel. Welcome, Daniel. It's good to have you with us.
Good morning, everyone. It's great to be with you. Let me just start off by saying a massive thank you for the support of Reach Mentoring and your Christmas giving. It's great to be with you, and a special thank you to Brian for the invite along this morning. My name is Daniel Wright. I am the Community Engagement and Fundraising Coordinator for Reach Mentoring. And I suppose this morning what I want to do is bring to you a little bit about the work that we do, who we are, what we do and why we do what we do, I suppose. And those are the things that I would like to get across in the message this morning. For the next 7 minutes or so, I'll just give you a little insight into all of that. So who are we? Reach Mentoring is a charity, a Christian charity, that with the mission statement that we are compelled by the love for Jesus Christ. Reach Mentoring exists to enable young people to unleash their full potential. It creates positive, informing and empowering mentoring relationships while working in partnership with local schools, churches and relevant agencies. I suppose a little bit into the background of Reach Mentoring. Reach is quite a unique story. It was formed and started off in the town of Lurgan, which is where I'm from. No boo. It's where I'm from. And youth workers in the local community got together to help young people, and there was a recognition that there was a real need to start to serve the young people greater in that town. And I suppose off the back of that, they came up with this idea that actually we're better to serve the young people than where they spend most of their time, which is in local schools. And so upon conversation with local school leaders, the youth workers developed what were called personal development sessions that were, I suppose, around topics that were arising within schools at that time. And they were delivered to large crowds of pupils on a monthly or bi-monthly basis. But as they did that, the youth workers very quickly realised that the young people wanted to talk on a one-to-one basis. And so coming away from those personal development sessions, the question was asked amongst these youth workers, what would it look like to do this on a one-to-one basis? What would it look like to do this and mentor these young people on a one-to-one scenario? And so out of those conversations, Reach Mentoring was formed. And for the last 8 years or so, Reach has taken on the story of one-to-one mentoring within schools with pupils who are going through challenging life circumstances. So what do we do? What does that look like practically? In a nutshell, we partner with local schools to mentor young people who are navigating through difficult life circumstances. I'm sure many of us can sympathise and recognise that we are living in an ever-increasing complex world, and our young people are faced with so many issues, as we all are, but they're faced with so many issues that I suppose even myself didn't have growing up. And all we have to do is look across the world and open our phones to see some of the stuff that our young people are faced with on a day-to-day basis. Practically, our work takes quite a bit of logistical planning and coordinating, as we partner with over 46 schools across Armagh, Banbridge, Craigavon, Dungannon, Lurgan and Portadown. Our latest data last year presented that we had mentored 753 young people in a one-to-one setting and have utilised over 70 volunteers in that time. When starting in a school, we aim to team up with the school's pastoral care teams, which ultimately allows us to identify pupils that are in need of additional support or perhaps a place to talk to somebody within school. Each of our sessions are weekly and they last around 30 minutes. And pupils are provided with a one-to-one space for the minimum of one school term. It's actually very common for our young people to be with us over a period of several terms, even years, and it is our belief that the best mentoring relationships are formed over time. So why do we do what we do? What's our inspiration for this? As we take a brief moment just to look at why we do, it's helpful to look at our mission statement. Reach Mentoring is compelled by the love of Jesus Christ. We do what we do ultimately because we want to show people the practical love of Jesus. We do what we do because, as it says in 1 John 4 verse 19, we love because Christ first loved us. At Reach, it is not our goal or objective to preach to our young people. Rather, it is our hope that they will see the love of Jesus through our actions. As we listen to each pupil on a weekly basis and navigate through some really complex and difficult scenarios, it is our hope that they feel heard and that ultimately they will feel the love of Jesus Christ through our consistent engagement with them. Biblically, Reach has often related the work that we carry out to the passage in Luke 24, where Jesus meets with Cleopas and another individual on the road to Emmaus. For us at Reach Mentoring, Jesus' actions and attitudes in this passage are central to why we do what we do, particularly in verse 15, where we are told that Jesus draws near to the two people. You know, in those moments, Jesus knew exactly what these people were thinking. He knew exactly how they were feeling, and he knew exactly what they were going through. But yet he took time to draw near, and he simply listened. He gave them a space and a chance to tell their story. They spoke of their unfulfilled hopes, their dashed dreams, their disbelief and confusion. And for us at Reach Mentoring, this is the example we seek to follow with our children and our young people. Being intentional with them to draw near, to allow them a space to offload the worries and the fears of their lives, and to share and to be supported. As a charity, we are entering into our 10th year, which is phenomenal, really, when we think back to God's faithfulness to us. We're so grateful. But as I think a little bit about the impact of the work that we do in some of the schools and the places that we work, it's helpful to give you some statistics and quotes. In the year 21 and 22, we mentored in 43 schools across 6 locations, mentoring a total of 486 pupils. So without growing geographically and serving within the same 6 locations, in the year 22-23, that number has increased to 46 schools and 753 young people. And despite school budgets being cut and the government engaged funding, which came off the back of the pandemic, ceasing, it has now stopped. Our Connect programme, which is where schools pay for additional mentoring hours, has actually grown significantly. And it highlights one major fact. The need for our service within our schools is great, and it is deeply valued. Within these 753 young people, data reported last year that 97% of them noted that Reach Mentoring was extremely helpful as they journeyed through life's ups and downs. The reality within our schools is this, that so often our teachers, and indeed the schools by themselves, simply do not have the capacity to deal with individual circumstances that they are presented within a classroom setting. I know that whenever I went to school, school classes were in a maximum of around 20. Very often in schools now we're looking at 30 plus, and so teachers' workload has significantly increased. We maybe even in some cases have 40 in classes, which is crazy to think. But actually teachers do not have the capacity to deal with situations on a one-to-one basis. And so the role of Reach within a school setting is very clear. It is to journey alongside the schools to help them and to help the young people that come through their doors every single day. We are there for the tearful, we are there for the brokenhearted, the joyful, the kids who feel like they are the misfits, for the kids who feel like they have nobody to turn to, for the kids who feel like they have to be somebody that they're not. We are there to listen to them, we are there to challenge them, we are there to hear their voice and to make sure that their story is heard. It's helpful to look at a little quote from a school within the Banbridge area, which is where I was speaking this morning. So a school within the Banbridge area. Reach has continued to be a massive presence within our school. Having a Reach worker in school every week has been extremely important for so many of our vulnerable children who are in school for supervised learning. It came out of a recent LAC review, so LAC standing for Looked After Children, with social services, that one of our pupils stated that he cannot talk to anyone about his feelings, to his parents, to his foster parents, to teachers or to friends. Rather, the only person that he feels he can speak to is his Reach mentor on a Tuesday morning. I suppose you're sitting here this morning and you're thinking, how can you get involved? What could I do to help with this? You guys have already done that with your Christmas give, and we are so, so grateful for that. Ultimately, we like to say that there are 3 ways in which you can support us. Firstly, and most importantly, is through prayer. We believe what we do works because we pray to a God who is faithful and who hears us. And so this week, if you're praying, it would be great if you could remember the work of Reach Mentoring, specifically thinking about the following areas. Schools, their leaders and their boards. The Education Authority at a really difficult time as they make some key decisions over the next few months and years ahead. Teachers, classroom assistants and the pastoral care teams. Pupils themselves and their families. Our mentoring coordinators as they deliver our vision across the 6 areas. The second way that you can support is by volunteering. I know that everybody's not in the position to volunteer. People work, people have jobs, people have lives, people are busy. But the nature of our work relies heavily on volunteer support. If I go into a school and there are 10 school periods within a day, I can mentor a maximum of 10 pupils per day. But if I bring in another volunteer, or I bring another two or three volunteers, we can significantly increase the service that we offer within each school. And currently our figure stands at 70 volunteers. And God has been so, so faithful to us with our volunteers. It's something that we've put a real push on this year. And actually through engagement with local churches and local communities, we have seen a real fruition and faithfulness within our volunteer support, and we're so grateful for that. If that's something that you would like to get involved in, I had a question in the last service: how long or how much time is there a minimum? Actually, there is no minimum requirement. If you are in a position where you would like to give time to support our work through volunteering with our mentor coordinators in schools, you can do that as much as, or as little as you would like. And the other thing that I would say with our volunteering is, I think a lot of people think that you can only work with young people if you're of a certain age. That is not the case at all. Actually, it's really important for our young people to have Christian faithful Christians who have actually challenged or worked through challenging circumstances themselves, mentor them in life circumstances that they face. And the final way in which you can support our work, and you guys have done this as a church, is to give financially. We're a Christian charity, and the work that we carry out is only made possible by your generous support. And as we enter into this new season, it is our aim to make each of the six areas in which we currently serve financially sustainable. Currently, we rely on grants quite a lot for actually a lot of our support. But actually, we have a really faithful business support and a really faithful individual support. And it's our aim over the next sort of 3 years to try and rely less heavily on grants. Grants are a minefield. You could apply for 80 of them and get one. And so ultimately, it takes a lot of time and energy and effort into grant applications. And we want to become self-sustainable as a charity over the next few years. And with this in mind, we're always looking for ways to partner with local businesses, individuals and churches. And so I would ask this morning, if you're in the position, or if you know somebody that would be in the position to support, then please do come and speak to me. I forgot my stand and order forms this morning, but I've promised that I'm going to give them to Brian to put out next week. So if you're here and you want to take a stand and order form next week, they will be here. I just want to take this time in closing to say a massive thank you. Genuinely, it is so great to be able to connect with churches like yourselves. I know that you guys will be praying this week, and so please, it would be brilliant if in your prayers you could remember the work that we do. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your time. Perhaps just say a bit in a moment. And just to ask that question again, for those who may still be wondering quite what happens in a half an hour, can you just give a taste of what a half an hour session would be like with one of the young people that you mentor?
So mentoring is actually a very, very relaxed format. We're not a counselling service. Ultimately, the idea with our mentoring sessions is that young people come in. Generally speaking, we have a little cup of tea and we have a biscuit, and we take about 5 minutes to have a chat about how our week's going. And after a period of time, very, very quickly, we realise that this person is coming to mentoring for a reason. And so over the weeks, those conversations become much more engaging and much more serious. And so I have a child that I'm mentoring and have been mentoring over the last few years who has lost both parents within months of each other. And so those are the sort of issues that we deal with. Ultimately, children don't come in and talk about that straight away. It takes a level of engagement and relationship building for them to feel safe and for them to feel comfortable in sharing some of the issues that they're working through. And so our half an hour session is very much tailored to whatever that individual child needs. Some people may come in and they are really just not enjoying going to school, and so they need a little bit of encouragement and support. Some people are coming in with behavioural issues and school have referred them to us. Some people are coming in with some really complex life issues, and we've had some really, really challenging mentoring sessions over the course of the last few years, specifically off the back of the pandemic, and that has highlighted a lot of fears and anxieties within young people, which are now starting to come out. And ultimately, that 30-minute session in a child's week, it can be completely invaluable to them, you know. Thank you.
I wonder if there's anyone who may have a question that you're burning to ask. Burning question that you'd like to ask. Anyone?
What skill sets do your volunteers need?
Yeah, so one thing that we say with our volunteers is actually what your life experience is a huge impact on those sessions. One thing that we say with all our volunteers is that they subscribe to a Christian ethos and faith. We are a Christian charity, and so ultimately our volunteers, we would love our volunteers to carry that as well. Our volunteers receive the necessary training before going into a school, and you never ever go into the school by yourself. So actually, one of the things that we get a lot of things, I would be afraid of that situation arising. Actually, the mentor coordinators are fully trained to deal with those situations, and should a volunteer ever feel, actually, I'm a little bit uncomfortable in this situation, or something's been shared that I'm struggling to help with, that is where our mentor coordinators are there and can step in. So actually, the biggest skill set that we ask for is that you subscribe to the Christian faith, and that actually you have time and capacity to give, and that's it.
I get the sense that there's a lot of listening involved, so just being a really good listener.
Yeah, exactly, and that is our ethos, very much so. We are providing a space for these young people. Should there be a situation, and it's important to highlight this, should there be a situation where actually we feel like this situation requires more of a skill set than what we can offer, then ultimately that is where our relationship with the school comes into play. We fall under the school's pastoral care teams. And so ultimately any referrals of critical incidents or incident report forms come straight into them, and the school and ourselves can ultimately help them find the help that they need, which is really important.
Thanks, Daniel. Thanks for your time and for explaining to us the work that you do, and for the invitation for us to be involved in whatever way in which we might be inspired to. Yeah. I just want to really affirm the work you're doing. For 4 years, when I was in my 20s, I worked as a youth pastor. I was a insecure young person, wasn't really sure of myself. Most youth pastors were extroverts. I was an introvert. But the one thing that I could do was to form relationships with young people. So I may not have been as entertaining as other youth pastors. But over those 4 years, I came to realize that simply forming a relationship with a young person, taking a deep interest in their lives, can make an enormous impact. It can be one of the most significant ways in which we can share the love of Christ. So absolutely. Really to affirm what you're doing. Thank you. And we've got a check for you
so
today
much.
Of £300. We realize it's probably a drop in the ocean in terms of your monthly costs. But it's something small to assist and to affirm the work you're doing. Can I ask, maybe, Mari, can you come and take a photograph just so we can, if you're okay with us? Okay. Should we come here in front? We'll get the flowers in. Let's get the flowers in. Daniel's second service, I'm not going to inflict my sermon on him a second time. Daniel, you must feel free to leave as we start singing the next hymn. Thank you so much for your time. And Daniel has said if anyone is interested to find any more information, please be in contact. I can pass on Daniel's contact details. And if you'd like to support them financially, I'll have some forms that you could fill in next week. Great. Thank you. Thank you very much. We sing together number 857.
I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? in my heart. I, the Lord of snow and rain, I have borne my people's pain. I have wept for love of them, they turn away. I will break their hearts of stone, give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my word to them, whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of wind and flame, I will tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them, my hand will save. Finest bread I will provide, till their hearts are satisfied. I will give my life to them, whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart.
Please be seated. Just two brief readings. I won't ask you to turn to them. They're just two verses. Today we look at Mending Fences, part one, and next week we'll look at part two as we explore the theme of restitution or making amends. Proverbs 14, verse 9 says, "Fools mock at making amends for sin, but goodwill is found among the upright." And then Romans 12, verse 18. "If possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone." Let's pause for a moment of prayer. O gracious God, out of the stillness and out of the reflections of our hearts, so we pray that as we reflect together, we would hear again the whisper of your still small voice of love that invites us into fullness of life. In Jesus' name. Amen. Mending Fences, part one. And it's part of our series exploring the 12-step program. We're getting to the latter half of it, or nearer the end of it. The 12-step program was originally part of, or is part of, Alcoholics Anonymous. That is the program that they run. But it has wisdom for all of us. And so we reflect today on step 8. Trevor Hudson, in his book that we're exploring with this theme, tells us how he once took part in a discussion group on the question, in what area of your life have you failed the most? And he says that his answer was not long in coming. He says it was not in the academic arena, nor in the sporting or the vocational or the financial. He says that while he had certainly blown it more than once in each of those areas, they were not his biggest failures. By contrast, he says that his biggest failures in life have all been in his relationships. He says that he cannot believe how many times he has let down his family, his friends, and his colleagues through things that he did or things that he failed to do. And he remembers one particularly painful moment in his marriage. He says it was early on in his ministry. He had just taken responsibility for his first congregation, and keen to succeed, he worked long and hard hours. Outwardly, he says, things looked like they were going well. Attendances and finances were both up, and there were even plans to extend or possibly build a new church building. But he says his marriage was not doing so well. He was often away from home or out late. He says he was denying the person closest to him of the attention and the time and the energy necessary for real communication and caring. And then one night, he came home to find a note next to his bedside, which read as follows: Trevor, I love you and want to be married to you. I sometimes worry, though, that one day I may no longer be worried if you don't come home. I miss you and want to reconnect. Debbie. Trevor asks, have you ever experienced similar moments in your relationships? The truth is, he suggests that if you have character flaws, then it is inevitable that in one way or another, you have stumbled into broken relationships of some kind or another. We all have. Because our character flaws don't only harm us, they inevitably harm others as well, especially those who are closest to us. It could be our desire to be in control, our explosive temper, our selfishness, our long-held resentments, our not speaking the whole truth, our deep-seated prejudices, or our wanting everything to be perfect around us, or, as in Trevor's case, our tendency to overcommit ourselves and to take on too much. Step 8 suggests that if we're going to grow spiritually, which is just another way of speaking of growing to human maturity, it's going to be important to take responsibility for the ways in which our character flaws impact other people, and then also to look at ways in which we can make amends wherever possible. And so step 8 says, or reads as follows: we made a list of all the persons we had harmed and became willing to make amends to them all. There are two parts to step 8. Firstly, making a list of all the people we have harmed. And secondly, becoming willing to make amends. In making a list of all the people we have harmed, we're invited to shine a light on all of our relationships, both past and present, to reflect on those relationships, to remember the faces of those who we may have hurt, to write down their names, to think carefully about what it was that we may have done or said or did not do that harmed them, and to consider the effect that this may have had upon them. Trevor says that this will be a difficult task. For when things do go wrong in our relationships, our normal response is to want to justify ourselves, to become defensive, to insist that we were in the right, to make excuses for ourselves, to blame the other person. The last thing we want to do is to admit that we may have done something wrong. We would much rather focus on how others have wronged us and how we have been the victim. But step 8 invites us to buck the trend, to turn it around, to challenge this deep-seated tendency to focus on our own victimhood. It's not to say that other people don't have their own stuff that they need to take responsibility for. Of course they do. But we can only take responsibility for our own actions. And if we wish to grow, we have to start with ourselves. And step 8 encourages us to do this by firstly making a list. Who have I harmed in my thoughts, my words, my actions, in what I have done, and in what I have failed to do? Are there perhaps people who immediately come to mind? Can we find the courage to write their names on a list? Can we describe, perhaps in a few words next to that name, what it was we did? Can we perhaps add a few words to describe the effect that this may have had on them? The second part of step 8 is about becoming willing to make amends. And I know in my own life, when I have felt that I've needed to make amends, it's felt like the last thing in the world that I've wanted to do. It can feel like a mountain too high to climb. And so how do we become willing to make amends? We can become aware, perhaps, of some of the benefits in doing so, and I mention 3 in particular. Firstly, making amends can help us deal with our feelings of guilt, remorse, shame, failure, resentment or anger or even hatred. Do you carry any of these painful feelings with you? And how would it feel if some of those could be lifted from you, removed? That's what making amends can do. It can help to release us from the grip of past failures and emotional baggage that we carry around because of them. Secondly, making amends can improve our health. It's becoming clearer and clearer in the medical profession that carrying around unresolved emotional baggage can end up doing terrible harm to our health. When we make amends and are released from some of this emotional baggage, and we find ourselves beginning to live in more harmonious relationships with others because broken fences have been mended, we begin to feel lighter in ourselves. And this can have an impact on improving our health even. And then thirdly, making amends can help reconnect us with a sense of joy. Broken relationships and the emotional baggage we carry around with us as a result of things we have done is they're probably one of the biggest things that rob us of our joy. But making amends can begin to open up again the gates of joy within our hearts, to begin to really experience a sense of God's forgiveness. In 2022, on our trip back to South Africa, I felt the need to make amends. 6 years previously, I had sold my car to a neighbor who had indicated he was interested in buying it if we moved and I had to sell it. And I felt this niggling feeling afterwards that I had overcharged him. I'd done my research and I charged him a price that other cars with a similar mileage, a similar model were priced at. But there were other factors that I hadn't considered in setting that price. And one of them was the fact that my car had been in an accident, and two of the doors were not original. For about 6 years, this had sat uneasily with me. And during that time, it would kind of resurface from time to time. And I had the thought numerous times of how I should put that right. In the end, I realized that it was robbing me of my peace of mind. And though it took a lot of courage, I decided to phone him and to pay him back some of the money that I had received from him. It felt painful, painful giving that money back. But afterwards, I was so grateful that I felt free of that uneasiness, that niggling feeling that just wouldn't go away. After I'd paid him, I was released from it. And what a relief. What a relief it was to have a sense of peace of mind again. And so there are good reasons to make amends wherever possible. If we remind ourselves of them, it can help us to become willing to make amends. Restoring one's inner peace and one's joy is a very compelling reason to become willing to make amends. Now, next week, we explore part two of this. And part two is exploring the actual action of making amends. Today is simply about the possibility of making a list of people we may have harmed, and then to consider whether we may be willing in our hearts to make amends. I end with just a few verses of scripture. Proverbs 14, verse 9. Fools mock at making amends, but goodwill is found among the upright. Matthew 5, verse 23. So if you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First, be reconciled to your sister or brother, and then come and offer your gift. And lastly, Romans 12, verse 18. If possible, so far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. So that's just a little bit of food for thought as we continue this journey on, as we explore the 12 steps, and a bit of food for thought on your journey wherever you are at this moment. We ask the stewards then to wait on us for our offerings to God's work. Invite us just to pause in prayer together. And as we pause in prayer, I invite us to lift into God's love and grace all those that we bring on our hearts today who are in particular need. And today we think especially of all the volunteers in Reach Mentoring. We also think of all the youngsters who receive mentoring, and we pray your blessing, O God, upon each of them. And in the stillness, I invite you to think of the names that you carry in your heart today, and to voice them in the silence of your heart as we hold them in God's love. And with them we also hold into God's grace and peace those things that trouble us, those challenges that lie before us, that make us feel anxious. As we hold them into God's hands, praying for God's strength and God's wisdom, and for God's Spirit to be at work in all of those situations. In Jesus' name, Amen. We're going to sing our closing hymn, number 757. We'll just sing three verses of it. Hold on a moment, let me just find it. And we'll do the first, the third, and the fourth. First, third, and fourth. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roam, whatever my lot, you have taught me to say, it is well. My soul, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, my sin, the bliss of this glorious thought, my sin not in part, but the whole, is nailed to his cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the soul, with my soul, it is well with my soul. For me, be it Christ hence to live, if Jordan above me shall roll, no pang shall be mine, for in death as in life you will whisper your peace to my soul. It is well, it is well my soul, with my soul, it is well with my soul. We say the benediction, and now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. We've gone over the hour, so we won't sing the final blessing. May God bless you in the week ahead. I'll greet you at the door.